All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Hi, this is David Foster with Score Bucks County. It is exactly, according to my calculations, 7 o'clock. We'll give about 30 seconds yet for anybody who's in the process of signing on. In the meantime, I go over just one or two little quick housekeeping type things. On your screen is a box. I can't tell you where it is, but it's there. Within that box is a section called questions. It is there that you, during the presentation, as you have questions, you merely type them out. I will see them. And unless it's something that needs immediate attention, the plan is that we address all the questions at the conclusion of the presentation. Okay, so this is Score Bucks County. This is the third in our six-part series on digital marketing. Tonight's topic is effective email marketing. We thank Univest for sponsoring this series. And we are extremely fortunate to have with us tonight Marcia Armstrong. Marcia Pearson, who is the founder and president of emailmarketing.guru, obviously a company in email marketing. Marcia has extensive experience not only in marketing, but email marketing and websites and a whole variety of experiences that would take me forever to detail. And I think from her presentation, you'll realize the amount of information that she is capable of imparting. So without any further ado, I'll be quiet and turn it over to Marcia.
Thank you so much, Dave. I really appreciate it. I want to welcome everybody to tonight's effective email marketing presentation. I'm going to be talking to you a little bit about some of the things you can do with email marketing. As Dave said, my name is Marcia Pearson, and I'm the owner of emailmarketing.guru, which is also my website, so you're welcome to go there. I forgot to put on this slide my email address. You're certainly welcome to email me also with any questions that might get missed along the way. It's simply Marcia, my first name, M-A-R-S-H-A, at emailmarketing.guru. And my Facebook and Twitter are right there. All right, so the first slide is, what is email marketing? And I'm going to talk about what email marketing is. And I also want to talk about what email marketing is in terms of online marketing as a whole. So obviously the exact definition is delivering professional email communications to people who are interested in hearing what you have to say that they'll find valuable and that looks great. Okay? But I like to look at email marketing as part of the whole picture because it doesn't stand by itself. And marketing as a tool is not selling anything. So I always like to a moment just to remind people of what marketing exactly is, especially when you look at the online digital world in terms of marketing. And you might take this as a note because I don't have it on a slide, but I want to just talk to you about it for a minute. Okay, there are two parts to marketing online that are important. One is something you've probably heard of, which is the know, like, and trust thing. If you remember, what you've probably heard is that people have to know, like, and trust you, the person, to do business with you. Okay? So to know and like somebody is pretty easy. You know, you meet somebody at a networking event, maybe you have a glass of wine, a bite of cheese, you meet them, I mean, you get to know them a little bit, you like them, maybe you sit down for coffee and you get to know them. So that part's easy. That trust part, though, that's very, very hard because it's easy to get to know somebody, but if you're going to invest money with them, if you're going to invest more time with them, now it's a whole different thing. Some people are easy to trust. Some people take a little more time. And I used to equate this trust primarily to people who have a tough time with gaining that trust. Insurance people, finance people, people in accounting, anyone having to do with your money exactly, okay? But I did a boot camp recently, and I had somebody in the boot camp who was in the jewelry business. She has a jewelry store. And you really have to trust that person. If I'm going to go in and buy a diamond, I need to trust that the person is telling me the truth, not saying what a beautiful, flawless diamond this is, then I find out later it's really not so flawless at all. So you really need to have that trust. And that trust comes from marketing. When you market professionally so that people get to know who you are, you're increasing that trust factor. People to understand you and know you better and know the expertise that you have for what you do. The second reason we market, so the first one is increasing the trust factor. The second reason we market is because we want to increase brand awareness. And increasing brand awareness means that you're getting people to understand your brand better. That's why we buy Coke and not the store brand soda. That's why we buy, you know, whatever kind of Oikos yogurt instead of the store brand yogurt. Now, there are still people who are going to buy the store brand yogurt, don't get me wrong, or the store brand sodas or whatever it is. But that's why there's the marketing has sold us on those things. McDonald's, Nike, all those brands have worked very hard to gain huge brand recognition. And I'm not saying you need to have the same brand recognition as you do, but you need to have brand that comes from the area where you are so that people don't think of anyone but you. So we're going to look at email marketing as part of that overall scheme of increasing brand awareness and increasing the trust factor. Okay, so what it can do is it can drive revenue and profit, but not directly. Because remember, we're marketing. In marketing, we're getting people to understand us and trust us more so that they'll purchase from us. Okay, increase awareness. So you're going to find as we go through this that there's different kinds of emails that you can send out, and each email that you send out has a different purpose. And it can boost repeat business because now you're in front of people and reminding them that you're there. If you think that people will remember you're there, think again. I had a real estate person I spoke with last year. It was in December. And she said, you know what? My own cousin bought a house through another realtor. And her cousin even lives locally. I'm here in Philadelphia. She lives locally and bought a house through someone else. Why? You've got to constantly tap people on the shoulder and say, I'm here, and guess what I know? I know everything that you need to know about whatever it is, selling your house, selling a piece of jewelry, accounting, you fill in the blank. I've had bakers, I've had everything, candlestick makers. So no matter who you are, you have to keep in front of people, and email marketing is the best thing for that, and I'm going to show you why. Okay, so harnessing the power of the inbox. I know you're all ready. All right, so let's look at our agenda for today. First of all, why email marketing? I've covered a little of that already. And some of the pieces, I'm just going to bring everything up here, okay? One of the things we're going to look at today, how to really grow a healthy list of email contacts who want to hear from you, creating great content, designing a beautiful template, and getting it open. And finally, tracking what happens, because metrics are an important part of what we do. So why email marketing? Okay, what is the number one app on smartphones? Now, you know, I know you know this is like a leading question, that you know I'm going to say email, okay? Now, this little tidbit here that more people own a cell phone than a toothbrush, it's to give you that ugh factor. That's kind of like an old that's a thing that it's been around for a couple of years, so I don't know if it's still true or not. But I will say that I don't have any way to see what you guys are doing there, but I'll ask Dave. Do you still there? Are you there, Dave? Dave? Okay, Dave isn't there. He stepped away. Okay, so I'm just going to ask you, hypothetically, how many of you looked at your email on your phone today? Okay, I don't have a way to see your hands if you raise them. All right, but I will bet that most of you would raise your hand and say that you did. It's an important thing to note when you think about that. Email is the number one reason people use their phones. Using it as a phone is far down the list, all right? 91% of people check their email daily. I dare say it's probably more than that, okay? And 88% of people regularly check their email on their smartphone. It's one of the first things I do every morning, all right? Email's reliable, okay, and gets delivered 90% plus of the time. I won't have time today for me to do my whole spiel on email delivery, okay? But it is a whole task that it has to take to get from where you write the email to the person's inbox, okay? Facebook posts, this is comparing this to Facebook posts, but you can compare it to a lot of things, okay? If you look at, let's look at Twitter instead, just for giggles, a different kind of way of looking at things. If you post something on Twitter, even if it's great, okay, by the time it's in my news feed and I see it, if I'm not looking all the time at my feed on Twitter, it really kind of gets buried amongst all the other things that people have to say, unless I've sorted you out. But if I don't, it's going to get buried pretty quickly. I call that the half-life of something that you say on Twitter. Same with Facebook. There's a couple of things at play there. Number one, Facebook is only going to put the thing you put on your page in 15 out of 100 people's newsfeed. Now, if it gets some action or if you've been very active, it may go out to a little bit more. But here's the thing. It goes on into my news feed. Well, I'm here right now. Now, if I were home, I might look at my Facebook, but I'm not doing that because I'm here. So if you posted something, it could pass me by. And I might not see it, even though I might want to see it and might want to know what you're doing. Therefore, email on the smartphones that we look at all the time, it's going to be your better bet. All right? It works everywhere. Okay? Email has a higher conversion rate than social media because people see it, okay? And for every dollar spent, this has gone up slightly. It used to be $41 and change. Now it's 44 and a quarter, and that's as of 2015, okay? And return on investment, that's what ROI means. It means for every dollar you invest, you get 44 bucks back. Don't you want that in your pocket? First impressions matter. All right, so we're going to look at this, these dead flower versus perky flowers in terms of emails. When we talk about emails, there are a couple ways of looking at it. The email on the left is an email that would be, let's say, written just in your Outlook. People write it in their Outlook. And they think they're very clever sending it as a BCC to all the people on their list. Okay, first of all, it's not in compliance with the CAN-SPAM Act of 2003. It was actually enacted January 1st, 2004. Okay, so you're likely missing a lot of compliance and you don't know what's happening with your email. Okay, where the one on the right has the logo, matches coloring on the website, has an attractive look. No one's going to read this whole big paragraph here. We just established that people are looking at it on their cell phone, that little bitty computer that you hold in your hand, Okay, so who's going to read all this? You just need to get to the point and people get to shop. So let's look at a couple reasons why it doesn't work. Okay, we mentioned a couple already. Potential spam complaints. Okay, that goes to the Spam Can Act. Okay. Limited sending, so when you're sending this via your Outlook, there's a chance you can only send it to up to 50 people at a time. So if you want to send it to 3,000 people, how are you going to do that? Okay, I know somebody who did that once, and her address almost got blackballed by the internet powers that be. No formatting control. Susceptible to filters, and I'm not going to talk a lot about filters tonight, but it is one of the main things that we talk about when we think of deliverability of email just in general. No cohesive branding, so how do people even know it's you? Spam complaints, and no tracking or reporting, so you don't have any way to know whether someone received it or didn't receive it, or whether they called it spam, because if people are calling it spam, you could be putting yourself in jeopardy, right? So tonight's presentation is also a little bit in part sponsored by Constant Contact, and it doesn't matter which email provider you use, whether it's Constant Contact, MailChimp, or anyone else, okay? You've got great templates with drag and drop capability, so they're easy to work with, great brand identity. You can manage or subscribe to your emails easily, and moreover, they help you obey the law, which is important. I know we think it's not here in the United States, but it really is. Canada overhauled their laws in 2014, okay, and I can't help but think that the U.S. might not be too far behind if we aren't careful in how we handle email marketing as a country, all right? So let's talk about your list, all right? So you can't just put anybody on your list because that's against the law, okay? So what you're going to be able to do is to ask people if they'd like to be on your list. So anywhere where you are, where you meet somebody and they hand you their business card, you say to them, I'm going to add you to my mailing list. Is that okay? I've never had somebody say no, but they certainly could say no, and that's okay. So the importance is to ask permission and find ways to do that. You want to express that? I think we're all from the Bucks County or Montgomery County or somewhere in that area. If there's anybody on today's call from Canada by any chance, okay, then you want to look at your own laws for that country. Okay, I'm just going to bring all these up here, okay? So it's important that you ask permission because you have to be sure that somebody wants your message. And by the way, why would you want to send your message to somebody who didn't want to hear from you? It's akin to making that phone call to somebody. Did anybody ever cold call you at home and they call you and say, hi, Mr. Smith, would you like to, your chimney's cleaned? And you like want to hang up on them, but you say, no, thank you, and then you hang up. So it's like that, but in your email box. So why should you send out junk to people who don't want your junk? You don't see it as junk, but that's how that person sees it. So people who want to hear from you don't see it that way. They see it as something they want, and they're seeing, and they want to hear more from you. So a couple of ways you can ask, okay? One is by putting it on your mailing list. I mean, on your website, a little join my list button right on your website, okay? So people sign up and they get a little form like this that they fill out. All right, if you have an event coming up, you can use QR codes, but PS, just one thing, do not use QR codes on your website. That's not where they go. You put a join my list button or a little form there. Sidewalk signs, we're going to look at that, boxes, fish bowls, anywhere, all right? And that fish bowl thing you often see in restaurants. There'll be a fish bowl there and it'll say, you know, put your card in here for free dinner for two. We have a new winner every month. Okay. And P.S., if you're going to have a fishbowl for business, make sure you also say it will be added to our mailing list. So I'm going to just bring this up here. This sign where it says text Salon Bella to 22828 is what we call text to join. And in the text to join, Constant Contact has purchased this number 22828, and the name or the word that you text to that has to be unique. So for me, if you text the word Philly, P-H-I-L-L-Y, to 22828, you'll get a response back that says, would you like to, glad you're interested in my mailing list. Please text back your email address to join up. You type in your email address and hit send, and you get a second email back that, or text back, and text says, thanks for signing up. I send out monthly tips and interesting ideas for increasing your online marketing. And that's how it works. QR codes. QR codes are great on business cards. They're also great if you're doing maybe an expo or any kind of a community event where you might have a table. It's a good place to use a QR code, all right? And it just simply, they scan the code and they get taken to a form like this one here on the left. Now, I'm a big one for giving people a reason to join up, because there are a lot of people looking for you to join their list. If you make a purchase from someone, you're likely going to be getting emails from them, and you can always subscribe, unsubscribe. I mean, that's a given, okay? But for us, so smaller people who have small businesses, sometimes a little offering them a little something in exchange for their email address is a good idea. For me, I have a book that I wrote, How to Create Famously Great Content. You can go to the homepage of my website. You can click on the little link there and put in your email address, and you'll get my online book, PDF book. All right, I also have another one with five resources that people can use, online resources. Anything that you can offer people, if you have a retail store, of course, you can offer them a discount or something free, okay, that you can offer them. So what you're going to need for that would be something like a landing page or somewhere where people will go and you'll capture their email address for that information. All right. Creating great content. Content is the main reason we do everything. I do my web, I spend a few hours talking about content, okay? But it's all about them, not you, okay? You need to look at what your readers want to see. And remember the mobile phone, okay? It's the reason why you have to keep it short. Those days of long rambling emails are gone, of long rambling paragraphs and so on, okay? You need to find a way to connect with people in a very small space. So remember, it's about them, not you. If it's boring, people are going to unsubscribe or send it to spam, okay? So we need to look at what's important to them. So this would be a good example of five common grooming mistakes where someone may have asked a question about a business owner and said, you know, what are things that people do wrong every time they groom their dog? They say, hey, I can make a blog post out of that, and P.S. also put it into email. Less is more when it comes to emails, so remember, this is that mobile phone thing. Pictures do still say 1,000 words, so you do need some pictures. And just a few lines of text, not too much. What we found, and this was a survey that was done, that the more clicks you have or places for people to click, the less likely people are going to do it. So if you have as many as 5 clicks, the chance someone's going to click is going to go way down. If you have one thing for people to click on, they're more apt to click, and it should be a button, not little words like this. These examples here show these small words right here. Better if it's a button. Let me see. We'll see another example. I was going to go back, but I think it's too far back. So look at questions that people ask you. And how can you take a question somebody asks you and turn it into something that's important? Right? And remember that we are visual people. That's just how we are. As a species, we're visual. I don't look at this little pile of chocolate and get excited, but if I see chocolate just in general, it's going to give me a better clue or a better cue than just reading the words alone. So when you include your photos, be sure that you use the right size. Emails are no more than about 600 pixels wide. And occasionally you'll see a layout that's a little wider. So your image doesn't have to be more than 700 pixels wide or so. Avoid copyright issues. There are lots of places you can get free images that you can use. Freeimages.com is one of them. But keep in mind that even freeimages.com is the image site of a paid image site. So iStockPhoto sells photos, but they've put together this free image site as a marketing, let's call it a gimmick, even though it's not exactly a gimmick, but a little way to get people in front of their images. So when you go to freeimages.com and you want to look for dogs, you might also see mixed in there some dogs that are paid ones. So you have to click on the little free images thing to make sure that you see only the free ones. All right, and also look for stock images. There are tons of free image sites. Freeimages.com is just one of them. Okay. Communicating through your content means making your image clickable, and what that means is if someone mouses over the image, can click on that and go to your website, or if it's an article about something like if you're in the travel industry and it's an article about Miami, and there's a picture, make that click through to your tour of Miami that people can go on. All right? Keep key action above the scroll. Above the scroll is a term that came out of the newspaper industry. In the newspaper industry, it used to be called above the fold. So you'd want to be in the top half of the newspaper. And the reason for that is in cities where people read newspapers and they're sitting on a bus or a subway, the bottom part of the newspaper was in their lap, so people might not look at it as much. They're going to just finger through the top. I've seen people do it 1,000 times. All right, so keeping things above the fold is interpreted today as being above the scroll, and what that means is before I scroll down here on the screen, you listen, I can click on it without scrolling down. Also, limit choices. We talked about that a few minutes ago. No more than about 3 choices is good, okay? You know, it's easy to look great. It is so easy, okay? Just make sure that when you do send out an email that it looks great on your phone. Your branding should match your website. Your website brand should match your Facebook page. Your Facebook page should match your Twitter. It should match your LinkedIn. It should match your Pinterest. It should match your whatever it is else you've got. Okay? They all should have elements of your brand in them so people know that's what it is. So again, like I said, be consistent. Images use similar language. A lot of people don't think of that as being part of their brand. But when I do my boot camp and I talk to people about their brand, we talk for a half an hour about the language of your brand, whether you're serious, whether you're playful, whether you're fun, whether you're witty. What are some of the words that you're going to use that make up who you are? Because there's a good chance if you have a business that's going to grow, you aren't always going to be the one doing the social media or making those posts or preparing the email. So you need to be able to prepare guidelines that the person you're going to hire to do that can follow, so that they're also using language and image and consistency with your brand and who you are. All right, just a couple of examples of types of emails. Newsletters, okay, which simply are like a monthly newsletter. Maybe an announcement if you have some new product or a new employee or something like that. Maybe a special event or promotions. Or you might want to be asking for feedback. So some of these things go together. You might have a special event. Let's say you're having a black tie dinner this Saturday. Afterwards, you might want to send out something for feedback, and you might give people some kind of coupon. So I'm just going to bring up everything here. Okay. In the old days of email marketing, and by old days I mean like 5 years ago, we used to sometimes have a template for email that had what I call a sidebar, either on the right or the left. And that's sort of gone away, again, because of mobile telephones. Okay? That's why we want to keep a single column, because it looks better on a phone. No more than a couple of images and no more than 20 lines of text. No more than a couple of links. You can see how nice and clean this looks. It has a much nicer look than if you just simply send something out through your Outlook. And about, of course, the action above the scroll line. So why are people going to open your emails? Let's look at it. Now, the first thing is, who sent it? How do people know you? Do they know your company? Do they know you, your name? So I usually use Marcia, emailmarketing.guru. Hopefully that covers all bases. Some people might know you as, you know, Jane Doe, or some people might know you as Acme Company. You want to be sure that people, when they get the email, don't go, who's Jane Doe? I don't know who that is. Spam. Okay? It's important that even across all channels, email being a channel, Facebook is a channel, Pinterest is a channel, and so on. Across all channels, people know who you are, and you're recognized for who you are. Subject lines. So I'm going to give you a tool for subject lines. Because if you don't really write a great subject line, then people may not want to open your emails. Okay? You want to be clear, but you want to be clever. And what I like to use is a tool. It's at aminstitute.com. That's A as in Apple, M as in Mary, institute.com. And you'll click on Headline Analyzer. And in there you'll type your headline. It has to be four words or more. And hit enter. And it's going to ask you, it's going to give you what's called an emotional marketing value for your headline. Headline slash subject line, whatever. All right. And they call that an EMV. And I think you'll find it interesting. Okay, there are other tools that are sort of similar to this. I happen to like this one. It's simple and easy to use. They don't ask anything from me in terms of my email address or anything else. I can simply use it, and it's quick to confound me with other stuff, okay? So that way you can write a great subject line that you think people will want to read. When you talk about your subject line, you don't want it to be too awfully long. And being kind of a smart aleck, I would say, you know why? It's that darn telephone again. Okay, it begins to rule our lives after a while. because if you make the subject line too long, it'll go off the edge of the phone, and people might not read the end of your subject line, and it could cut in a strange spot where you don't expect it to cut. So you always have to look at it yourself too beforehand and make sure that it makes sense as well. Okay. Pre-header text is this little text right here at the top. And because I use Gmail, I see pre-header text just like this. It would say the name, subject line, and a little bit of that pre-header text. Okay? And it kind of gives sometimes people a little bit about what the email is. Usually you don't want that to be more than a sentence or so. Okay? When you're writing your subject line, also be aware of spam-like words. You don't want to use words that seem like spam to people. Okay? And these are some of them. A couple of reasons are your email could get stuck in a spam filter and not get delivered. All right. Don't forget timing. Okay. Oops. One of the questions I get most often is, how often should I send my emails? Monthly is most common, unless you have an event coming up. Okay. For day and time, you know, hey, send your emails Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, anytime between 10 and 3 and all that, but it's different for everybody. And Constant Contact, who's been around for eons, okay, they've been around for about 18 years now, okay, based on people who use their system, they've kind of come up with kind of a little thumbnail for some businesses, okay. It's not exactly cut in stone. You can still do some testing on your own to figure it out, but it might help, okay? Emails with social media buttons, people are going to click through to them, and that's right up here at the top. All right, and lastly, tracking your results. Don't guess, okay? Know what metrics are important, and use that to make decisions. And part of that might help you decide when's the best time to send your email, as an example. Look at open rates and see how many people have actually opened your email. And you can actually see the people who have opened your email. You can look at click-throughs. That is how many people clicked on any of your links. So if 74 people clicked on this link right here, whatever that is, there might be a reason to identify that group as a little subgroup, make a separate list out of those people, and target them in a different way. Because that's a fairly significant number of people, considering the number of people who opened it, which was 98, assuming it would be that those go together. All right. And lastly, people who did not open, okay? It's a good way to find ways to re-engage them. Try and figure out why they didn't open it. If you sent your email at a different time than you normally send it, maybe you need to do some testing to figure out what makes that work or not work. Moreover, anybody who opts out. Now, someone's opting out, it's sort of a gift. They're simply saying no thank you. And sometimes it has nothing to do with you. It's just, as a person, they just receive too much email and it overwhelms them. So unfortunately, they've chose to not get email from you right now. If you have a tremendous number of people who are opting out, now that's a different story. Now you want to look at why they're opting out. Are you not sending a message that's clear or important to people? And lastly, bounces. There are two different kinds of bounces. There's hard bounces and soft bounces. Hard bounces are where the person doesn't have the email address anymore, or it's their email address might be suspended for various reasons. Soft bounces are when people have their mailbox full, or maybe that I'm on vacation thing is on. Okay, sometimes email won't get delivered for that. and those are called soft bounces. So to maintain a clean list, you want to take hard bounces and take them out. So lastly, I'm just going to put everything together. Let's look at what an ideal email looks like. Great subject line, includes the business name or your name if that's how people know you. Pre-header text, that little bit there. Okay. Make your logo clickable to your website. Communicate through other images. In the right-hand corner of your screen, that is at least if you have a PC, you have a little camera. You can click that and capture this picture if you like. Give you a second to do that. If you have a Mac, I don't know if it's there or not. All right. Last, bottom. Less is more. Focus on relevant content. Okay. Clear call to action above the line. A nice big button that people can see so it's obvious that you want them to do something. Minimize the number of links, no more than about 3. Okay. Apply your brand colors, in this case the green and purple, and include social media buttons. All right. Give you a second to take a picture of that. And off we go. I'll just say small business marketing is nurturing, keeping your promise, and getting measurable results. I also say it's being consistent in what you do. You can't start doing something and expect it to work and not keep doing it. There's no such thing as search engine optimization that's one and done. It doesn't work that way. You have to keep doing things, posting on Facebook, sending out emails. You have to keep it because the minute that you stop, people don't see you anymore. It's called social media for a reason, because it's social, all right? The great thing is you have an advantage because you have a connection to the people who you already know, and that's a great place to start is with people who already know you. Take your contacts, even if it's only 20 or 30 of them, connect them together, even if it's your grandmother, okay? Create a great email and get ready to send it, and then just watch what happens in terms of metrics. Okay, if you need my help, I'm really here for you. I want to tell you something that I truly want you to succeed. I truly do, okay? I put myself out there. I give my email address out freely. I want you to call me and contact me, okay? I really do, okay? It's something that you really can do. Now, I'm going to give you two different things just before we take some questions. I want to let you know that Constant Contact gave me permission to offer you your first 3 months of email marketing for $5. And to take advantage of that, you'll go to $5offer.com. All right. And you don't have to do it today. You have a couple of days, so feel free. $5offer.com. You're welcome to do that. All right. And I want to let you know that next Wednesday, I have a very special webinar with a guest of mine, Tim Page. And Tim Page is from Lead Pages, and he's going to talk about landing pages. And it really ties into your email because he's going to talk about how you can use landing pages to grow your email list. All right. So that's next Wednesday at 2 p.m. And you can sign up by going to my website, emailmarketing.guru, and just click on the events tab and look for that conversion journey email. Okay, so that's it. Are you still there, Dave?
Yes, I'm still here. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you, Mark.
I don't want to hang on that, like hanging on advertisement, which doesn't seem like that's unfair. I'm going to go right up here and hang on this one right here.
Okay.
There we go. Okay, so I'm ready.
Okay. Well, first, before we get to the questions, just before anybody ducks out, I want to let you know that we did record this webinar from start to finish. It takes a day, it takes overnight to process it. So look for an email either tomorrow, but most likely Friday, an email with a link to the YouTube location where this will be housed. So if you miss something or you want to go back and look at it again, that presentation is always there for you. Great. So thank you, Marcia. As usual, she is a font of information, and there was a lot of good stuff that was communicated today. We do have a couple of questions. Start with Rosemary, who asks, do you prefer Constant Contact over MailChimp? If so, why?
I would say there's a couple of things it has going for it. Number one, and first and foremost, if you think that you want to call somebody because you've got a problem, it's really great that they have people you can call right on the telephone. They're there 6 days a week. They're not there on Sundays.
Are you talking about Constant Contact or MailChimp?
That's Constant Contact. Okay. If you want to email somebody for an answer back within 24 hours, use MailChimp. I mean, if you have a problem, but there's a lot of people who are self-starters who use MailChimp who are very happy. Okay, so if you think you can muddle through it, that's fine. If you don't, Constant Contact might be a better way to go. Plus, if you use Constant Contact, and if you do use the $5 offer, by all means, call me. I'm there. I'll hold your hand every step of the way because I'm a partner with them, and happy to do that. So that's one of the main things that's got going for it, all right? Is the people factor, which is sometimes a big deal. I've decided I don't like dealing with people where you just got to email them or chat with them, and you know it's a waste of time. I want to send my email now.
Okay, good. All right. I hope that gives you some insight, Rosemary. If not, you can feel free to type another question. I got a question from Karen. Excuse me, she works with a national group of teachers who are becoming consultants. Can I share the link to the recorded webinar with them? I hope this brief webinar might interest them in customizing webinar with Marcia. So helpful. And of course, the answer is yes, you can share it. Let's see. Stacy asks a question. Hello, I use MailChimp. How do you set up the 20 lines of text and the Read More link? I hope you understand that, Marcia.
I do. Well, setting up text is just simply typing in the text. Okay. For a Read More link, that's typically called a hyperlink. Okay. And the way you do that is you're going to use your mouse to highlight the words that you want to, you'll read more, and then you're going to go up and link it to where you want that to go. Now, it's probably a little different with MailChimp, but probably not that much different. Sometimes the little link thing looks like a little piece of two chain links put together. So look for that, and that's how you're going to create the hyperlink of the words read more or click here or get more information, whatever the words are. It could be anything. Alrighty, hopefully that helps.
Yes, and I would just want to echo something Marcia said, that you know she is very amenable to, you know, if you have questions or concerns, email her, give her a buzz. She'll help you as much as possible, and she'll do it without banging you over the head to buy something. She just is very passionate about this material. Brian asks, do you have any recommendations on services to aid in creating fluid and engaging email marketing emails? I typically create my campaigns from scratch using MailChimp, and they're okay but not great.
Well, there are two elements when it comes to emails. Number one is what I call the theme, that is how it looks, which usually has your logo at the top and any colorings already pre-selected that match your website. So if you set up a great theme, usually when people use Constant Contact through me, if you use the $5 offer thing, that's how it'll be, then what I do is I set that theme up for you. You can't get it wrong. So that's what I do. And thereafter, you just put in the words that you want to say and any images that go with what you want to say in that particular month's email. Does that make sense, Dave? Did that sound like it would answer?
I think so. If not, he can, type something else or, okay, he said he gave me a yep, so that was good.
Okay, good.
Do you have any thought that Peter asked this question? Do you have any thoughts on the service SendPulse?
I do not know SendPulse. Are they another service provider like we sell?
I don't know. I never heard of them.
There are quite a few of them out there. There's one called iContact. There's GetResponse. I also use a product called Infusionsoft. It's on a different level, so it's not for everybody. But if you think that Constant Contact or MailChimp is not what you're looking for, you might consider something like that and let me know. I also work with AWeber. I also have Email by Marcia, so I have lots of different things that people can consider when it comes to email, different email types.
Right. Peter, certainly if you want to talk privately or, with Marcia, that would be, I would suggest that as well. Maybe she would learn. Anyway,
one thing I'd say, Dave, is that, look at the cost of it. If it seems like it's really expensive and you've got to make an initial investment, then you'll want to know a lot more about it as something like Infusionsoft, where you're making an investment right from the get-go. But if someone offers you a free trial, give it a go and see what the free trial is all about. Or if it's not too expensive, try it for a month or two and see how you like it. And if you don't like it, you can go on to a different one.
Okay. And we have one more question. It's from Brian. I have an e-commerce website where I collect email addresses to keep customers informed about product giveaways, upcoming deals, and new products. I get a good number of signups from this, but was wondering how else I can accelerate the rate at which I gather email addresses. Should I be doing paid advertising to get people to sign up on my product giveaway email list?
Yeah, so if you're giving product away for free, is that it? Is
yes.
It giving product away for free? Okay, so if you're giving product away for free, you might also consider giving that product away for free via your Facebook page. And Facebook no longer forces people to have to like your page to sign up, but you can put it on your Facebook page and now promote it via Facebook.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Promote that.
It does. Yeah, so you can either do marketing via Facebook or whatever, but advertising with Facebook is relatively inexpensive and a good way to increase.
And you can control how much you spend. So,
easily, and you can spend $10 a day and get some bang for your buck.
Yep.
That is if it's something people want. Remember that. It's all about engagement. If it's not something that excites people, well, and forget it. If you're going to, give me a free hour of a consultation for accounting, I'd be like, snore. Not going to do that.
Okay. So Brian likes your answer. He's done some of that before. Two more questions just came in. From Craig, is a custom professional mailbox at blank highly recommended to have set up before I start emailing?
Well, now, see, this goes to what I was talking about in terms of deliverability, but let me see if I can explain it. And let me go to the next question, and let me come back to that one.
Okay, the other question is, just wondering if there is a particularly good provider for realtors to use, if not Constant Contact or MailChimp. Could you suggest particularly fertile resources for content? Interesting.
For realtors, for content?
Yeah.
I do a whole boot camp, and I don't have any more coming up. My next boot camp will probably be in the beginning of April. I'll start it again. And it's 5 weeks of intensive training, and we talk about content. And it's huge for realtors. I had 3 realtors in my January class, and I had 4 in my February classes. Because I'll tell you, one of the things I spend a lot of time on is where to find content. I get that question a lot. But on the web, there's a few resources I can share with you very quickly. One is Feedly. Another one is Flipboard. So Feed, F-E-E-D-L-Y, and Flipboard. You can try going to those places. And they're what I call curation sites, where you can curate information very easily about any subject. I'll tell you what, sending emails as a realtor, that's easy. You share about how people can fix their yard, how they can fix their roof, about their plumbing, about their floors, about pets if you're going to sell your house. I mean, it doesn't only have to be about selling your house or maintaining your house. So it can be tons of great stuff. All right, so I'm going to go back now to that question just before, Dave.
Yeah.
All right, so here's the thing. Yes, it's important that you have my name at mywebsite.com, and I'm going to explain to you why. Let's say that my email is marcia@gmail.com. Okay, it's not, so don't email me there. Okay, so marcia@gmail.com, and I go to do my email marketing on Constant Contact. Okay, and I get ready to send my email, and I want to send it to john@gmail.com. He's on my mailing list. When I send the email, it's going from marcia@gmail.com via Constant Contact, in my example, it could be MailChimp or whatever, via Constant Contact to john@gmail.com. In between the Constant Contact part and John actually getting it in his mailbox is Google servers. Google servers look at that and they go, ding, 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 wait 1 second, here's a gmail.com piece of mail that did not originate on our servers. It looks suspicious. So we're just going to hold that back. So the problem here is that Marcia, who sent it, doesn't know it didn't get delivered. John doesn't know I sent it, so he didn't get it. It's just simply like stopped in nowhere land by Google servers. So that's why it's important for you to use me at mydomain.com. But the other thing I look at has less to do with, so that's huge. That deliverability thing is huge. And I hope that I did it justice just now in explaining that. You think it was clear, Dave?
I think so. It's a little tough to get, but I it makes sense.
I spent a half an hour talking about this.
Yeah.
All right.
So well, we have time for the last question, and I just want to
say one other thing with regard to that, and that is, how proud of your brand are you? Remember where I began an hour ago? The first things I said was brand awareness, increasing the trust factor. Write that down. Brand awareness, increasing the trust factor. So how much brand awareness do you think people are going to have if you're, you know, just chuck@gmail.com or yahoo.com or whatever? You know, let's have a little pride in that domain that I've spent hours looking for the domain I wanted. And I'm thinking probably you guys might have too. So have some pride. Use it.
All right.
Okay, last question.
Last question, and before everybody takes off again, thank you for joining us. I'm sure it was informative and helpful. Our next one will be on digital marketing aspects, focused mostly on how to utilize Facebook to increase revenues. So check your email. The last question comes from Robin. Is the EMV a percent? If so, what's a good score?
When you use the when you go to aminstitute.com and they give you what's called an EMV, the emotional marketing value, they tell you right below there. It'll say, you know, that, you know, a score of so and so is good, but the best copywriters typically have 40 to 50% EMV words, you know, and the best as much as 75%. So if you put in your subject line that you want, and you think, gee, you know, it only gave me an 18%, go back and tweak it just a little. Sometimes the tiniest tweak will make it come back up, bubble up, and it with a higher percentage. So it explains all that, and that's what I really like about it. It explains it, but it keeps it simple, so you're not spending too much time looking at it.
Okay. Thanks again, everybody, and check your email for the recording. And a week or so, you'll get an email about the next in the series. Thanks again to Marcia, and we are out.
Thank you very much, everybody. Good night.